What's up, guys? In this video, we're going to look at the stocks of AT&T and Verizon and see which one is a better deal right now. If you're new to the channel, hit that subscribe button, hit that like button. It helps me a lot, and you can check out my other stock analysis videos. All right, let's jump into it. All right, you guys probably know their business. These are telecom giants. Let's have a quick look at their stocks and see where we are right now. AT&T's got a market cap of about $204 billion. Their price-to-earnings ratio is about 9 right now, looking very attractive. And even more attractive, they have a 7.23% dividend yield. The stock is down about a quarter of its value in the past year. So a lot of people are asking, is this a really good deal? You know, why isn't anyone buying it? Or, you know, they're headed for bankruptcy. So it's very split opinion on AT&T right now. With Verizon, they're down just about 4% for the year. They have a similar market cap, $240 billion. They're yielding about 4.27%, and their price-earnings ratio is about 12. So it looks like they're priced at a little bit of a premium compared to AT&T. And people feel more stability in this company for some reason. Let's have a deeper look. So the way in which these two companies earn their money is fairly similar with some differences. Here for AT&T, you can see 78% of their revenues come from the communications division. You got 18% coming from Warner Media. That includes things like HBO, CNN, and Warner Brothers. Compare that to Verizon Wireless, where you've got close to 70% coming from Verizon Consumer and 24% coming from Verizon Business. Both of it is pretty much the same thing. We're talking about cell phone plans, wireless networks, things like that. And you've got 7% coming from other. So Verizon kind of lacks that entertainment aspect that AT&T has. Let's have a look at their balance sheets. The first thing I notice is Verizon has a bit of a higher leverage ratio there, with the liabilities to assets at about 77% compared to AT&T's 63. Got to consider that. As far as short-term financial problems, though, AT&T is in worse shape there. I hate to see a current ratio below 1 and the quick ratio even further below 1. If you don't know any of these ratios, I put them in the description below. But essentially, they're just a measure of your ability to pay your short-term obligations, and you don't want to see them drop below 1. Verizon's are not very impressive, but they are above 1, and that's a lot better than where AT&T is at. The interest coverage ratio for both companies is not great, but for AT&T, it's very concerning there. The interest coverage ratio measures how many times over can you pay your interest expense with the profits you bring in before interest and taxes this year. So for AT&T, they can only pay their interest expense about 3.68 times with the profits they earn. That's getting to be in the danger zone there. Both companies are pretty long-term asset intensive, and a lot of those assets are intangibles, like their branding. All right, so in terms of profitability, I'm doing a DuPont analysis here where I'm going to break down return on equity into its three parts. So Verizon is the clear winner in this category. You know, both companies have suffered declining ROEs, but for Verizon, they still managed to make a 29% return on equity in the most recent trailing 12-month period, whereas for AT&T, it's down to 5.5%, very poor. Now, what's driving that? Well, declining margins at AT&T, you hate to see that. You know, you look at Verizon, they still managed to earn a 14.3% profit margin, so that's respectable. They also just generally generate more sales revenue for a given level of assets. You can see that with their asset turnover, which is very stable at about 0.5, meaning they generate about 50 cents of sales for every dollar of assets in place. It did go down a little bit, but remember, we had a pandemic, so, you know, I expect it to go back up to 0.5, hopefully. You know, for AT&T, 0.31, you know, quite a bit worse. Now, Verizon's also has higher leverage with that equity multiplier, and that is one of the factors leading to their higher return on equity, but they also just generally have better margins and better asset turnover. So Verizon's clearly the better company in terms of profitability. Okay, so as far as dividends, this is the main reason people really like AT&T. They say, oh wow, 7% yield, AT&T, well-known big company, I'll take that. This is a heck of a lot better than having a bond right now. But this dividend could be in danger. I see their payout ratio is about 65%. So, you know, how much can they continue to raise that dividend? That is in question. We'll have to see. They do have a five-year dividend growth rate of about 2%, and they've been growing it for 36 years straight. So they have some credibility there. But, you know, you saw their balance sheet. We're not sure how things are going to be going forward. Now, you compare that to Verizon. Yes, Verizon's dividend is a lot lower, 4.27% there. But they're only taking about half of their profits and paying them out as dividends, which gives them a lot more room to raise that dividend going forward. They have a great history of that, 16 years straight. Another way of giving back to shareholders is through share buybacks. You can see here for AT&T in the red, they have done buybacks in 2017 to 2018. They did a little bit in 2019, and they did absolutely none this past 12 months. Even though the share price has dropped like a rock, they didn't buy their shares back. I think that shows you just how strapped for cash they are right now. If you compare that to Verizon, you know, Verizon's got a nice dividend streak in blue there. But notice the red as well. Verizon typically hasn't been one to buy their own shares back, but they went ahead and did just that during this past year. So that tells you a lot about both companies', you know, cash position. One concern I have with AT&T is their ability to keep paying dividends going forward. So in the blue, you've got the payout ratio. That means how much dividends did they pay divided by their total profit for the year. And you can see they're paying about 90% of what they made out as dividends. That's not really sustainable. You're going to have to see an increase in profitability, which right now doesn't look likely. And so that dividend is definitely in danger. In green, I have the modified payout ratio, which is all the money they spent on dividends plus all the money they spent on buybacks divided by their profits for the year. And in recent years, that has sometimes exceeded 100%. So again, that's not going to be sustainable. For Verizon, you have a much healthier picture here. They're really just taking anywhere from, you know, 38 to 46% of what they make and paying it out as dividends. If you add in the buybacks, they did massive buybacks the most recent period. It's still only about 75% of the profits they made, leaving them lots of money to reinvest back into the company or just buy their own shares back. All right, guys, so at this point in the video, it really looks like AT&T could be a classic value trap, a classic yield trap, where a company with a very attractive yield actually turns out to be a really poor investment. But to really make sure, I want to do an intrinsic valuation analysis. I'm going to use the free cash flow to equity model. I think in this situation, the use of a dividend discount model may be misleading. It may lead us to believe that AT&T is a superior investment. But the reality is, when you look at their payout ratios, it's pretty unlikely AT&T is going to be able to continue paying out so much and raising their dividend payout in the coming years. So I think a more realistic analysis might be the free cash flow to equity. So to make it work, I got to pick discount rates. I'm going to show you guys what the values would be under a number of different discount rates. And so you can make your own judgment. You know, I think 6 or 7% could be fair for Verizon, maybe a little bit higher for AT&T, but I'll show you all the numbers nevertheless. We need to estimate some kind of growth rate in free cash flows. Now, I'm going to assume a rather low rate based on all the information we have available from analyst forecast. That looks to be the case. We're looking at single-digit growth rate in the next 5 years. pretty much every year thereafter, I'm going to need to come up with a perpetual growth rate. You know, some rate that can just grow in perpetuity, just, you know, via inflation. All right, guys, so what we're looking at here is a valuation matrix. Every cell tells you what the fair value of AT&T would be for a given discount rate and a given growth rate in their free cash flows to equity over the next 5 years. After 5 years, we just assume 1.5% growth. So basically, the cell that I think is most fair, most likely, would probably be one of the ones in these rows. I think an 8 or 9% discount rate is about appropriate for AT&T given their risks. And how much are they going to be growing in the next 5 years? I'm not optimistic. I would probably lean towards, you know, maybe this cell right here or this one right here. So anywhere from about $19.50 to $23 a share would be the intrinsic value. Now, I wanted to show you everything if you feel differently, you know, but assuming this low single-digit growth rate, it's not going to be a good deal. And you can see that in the matrix below where I highlight the cells green if it's undervalued. It's really only undervalued under the most optimistic assumptions here. You know, what would it take to make AT&T a good deal? Some pretty big growth rates, you know. If we assume they're going to grow free cash flows to equity at, you know, anywhere from 7 to 10%, it becomes a reasonable deal, not an excellent deal. If we can say, oh, they're going to be growing at, you know, 12 to 15%, okay, now it's a good deal. Well, I'm sorry, I just don't think that's likely to happen. Let's have a look at Verizon Wireless. For them, I have anywhere from a 6 to 9% discount rate to reflect the fact that they have the safer balance sheet. And, you know, okay, which cell is most likely? I think 7% is fair. They have a nice stable business. Their free cash flow to equity has not been growing very much. I could very well see this cell right here being the most likely. 66.95 there. That would make it a good deal compared to the price today. Is it a good deal overall? Let's have a look at the matrix below here, which tells you how much of a discount in green or a premium in red that you're paying for Verizon under these assumptions. So to me, it has a lot of upside because, again, I'm in this row here. I'm thinking a 7% discount rate is fair. You know, if they're able to grow at 4% a year over the next 5 years, not even amazing growth, just 4%, the stock could be as much as 26% undervalued. That seems like a decent deal to me. Again, it's not the kind of stock that's going to triple you up, but it could be a nice addition to your portfolio. Let's have a look at insider trading activity. Now for AT&T, they have twice as many insiders buying as selling in the past 3 months. And they also have a lot of people buying compared to selling in the last 12 months. But if you look at the number of shares involved, yes, there are more transactions where people are buying, but the raw number of shares sold in the past 3 months is actually a lot more than the number of shares bought. So overall, a slightly negative indicator of what's to come for AT&T. For Verizon Wireless, there's really very little insider trading going on at the moment. Only 2 people selling, 0 people buying. And when we look at the number of shares involved, it really doesn't look that significant to me. So very little information there. All right, guys, so here are my final thoughts. First of all, make sure to hit that like button. It helps me a great deal. Secondly, AT&T versus Verizon. Verizon's the clear winner here. I mean, look, you're paying 12 times earnings compared to 9 times earnings, but you're getting much more stable company, much less risk in those earnings. Verizon's yield is very respectable, and they can really afford to keep raising that dividend. So it's a great dividend growth investment. When we run the numbers with the intrinsic value, it does appear to be undervalued under most scenarios, and we're not really assuming fantastic growth is coming or anything. So overall, you know, a pretty safe stock. I think it'd be a great stock to add to your portfolio if that's what you want to do. If you're really just looking for stocks that are going to outperform the market by a significant margin, you know, I'm not sure Verizon's going to do that for you. But, you know, for me, I'm going to buy some. I think it'd be a nice addition to my portfolio. Let me know what you're going to do in the comments below. Thank you for watching.